Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents Station Breaker by Andrew Mayne. Narrated by Kyle McCarley. Preface. All of the technology described in this book is either currently being tested on the launch pad or in advanced stages of development. This is a story of the very near future. Cosmodrome. Drops of blood trickled through Natalie Karatanova's fingertips and splattered into the puddle below. She caught her distraught reflection in the pool of water and the glow on the horizon as a RD-300 rocket engine fired on its test stand, lighting up the night sky over Baikonur Cosmodrome. Bracing herself against a silver sedan, smearing blood across the door, the roar was a distant hum under the sound of her own difficult breathing.
"Don't run,"
said the thick-jawed man from the window of the black Mercedes as he rolled up. Natalie pushed away from her resting spot and stumbled further into the parking lot, trying to find someone to help her. A minute ago, she was reaching for her keys when the two men came to a stop.
"Natalie!"
the driver had shouted, feigning familiarity. When she turned to look at who was calling to her, he fired his pistol. The noise startled her more than the wound. She thought a rock or something sharp had flicked her. It was the growing numbness and the sight of blood on her palms that told her what just happened. In an instant, she knew this was about what she had seen a few hours ago. It had been a clerical error. As a payload supervisor, normally it was her job to inspect all cargo before being loaded onto the Baikal rocket, except for military cargo. But this wasn't a military payload, or at least she hadn't thought so. There was no certificate from the Army, much less a liaison officer from Roscosmos. Clipboard in hand, Natalie had donned her cleanroom scrubs and entered the sterile chamber just like she did for every other launch. When she saw the plastic case sitting on the table, there was nothing indicating it was military. But when she cracked the seal and looked inside, she realized immediately there must have been some mistake. She quickly closed the case, but it was too late. The escort assigned to the cargo had re-entered the room, having momentarily abandoned his post. There were no words exchanged between them. Natalie made a quick exit, not even bothering to throw her garments into the bin. She headed straight for Supervisor Volodin's office, Roscosmos Chief Zhirov's right-hand man, and told him what she had seen. He listened carefully, made a call, then gave her a warm smile and told her it was just a mistake. Everything was fine. There had been a mix-up with some sensing equipment. Natalie thanked him, laughed it off, pretending the best she could. She knew he was lying. Having an engineering background, there was no mistaking what was in the case. She wasn't sure what she was going to do about it, if anything. Then the Mercedes pulled up, and the man shot her. Natalie managed to weave through another row of cars, but her legs were betraying her. Darkness began to encroach her peripheral vision as she continued to bleed out. She made one more stride, then collapsed on the wet pavement. Unable to move, yet still somewhat alert, she heard the footsteps of the approaching men.
"Get her into the bag, then place her into the trunk,"
one said to the other. Natalie felt their rough hands as they picked her up and laid her inside a plastic pouch, the kind they keep on board a spacecraft in case of a fatality. The scent of the material reminded her of a spacesuit, which set off a mental trigger in her mind. She remembered where she'd seen these men before. Their names were Yablokov and Domnin. They were cosmonauts. They weren't supposed to be here. They were supposed to be getting ready to launch in just a few hours. That thought faded as quickly as it came. When they zipped the bag over her head, she worried about her daughter, Elena. If Natalie didn't call and remind her, she would forget to start the oven, and dinner would be cold. 1. Space Gun. T-minus 4 hours. I think my commander is insane. Not the kind of insanity natural to anybody willing to sit on top of 1 million gallons of explosive fuel, but the workplace shooting kind of nuts. I tell myself I'm the crazy one. This is Commander Halston Bennett we're talking about. I've known him for years. Yet, a second ago, I saw him in the prep room mirror slipping a gun into the side pocket of his spacesuit when he didn't think anyone was looking. At first, I don't think anything of it. Bennett, after all, is the manliest man you'll ever meet. A former Navy pilot, SEAL instructor, and a NASA astronaut before coming to work for iCosmos. Of course a guy like him would carry a gun into space. Military pilots are taught hand-to-hand combat in case they come down in hostile territory. Russians keep pistols on their Soyuz craft in case they land somewhere with wolves, which is just about everywhere there. Maybe Bennett is just planning for any contingency? Hell, maybe he wants to shoot Martians. I try to put it out of my mind, but I can't. I should say something. Maybe it's just a standard operating procedure I don't know about. In that case, telling Renata, our launch manager, that he has a gun won't be a big deal. But what if it's Bennett's little secret? Maybe he's not supposed to do this, but the piece is his good luck charm. If I rat him out, he could be out of the company, and I'll probably catch shit for being the one that finked on an American hero. An American hero. Halston Bennett is the kind of man that made me want to become an astronaut. He's the man I want to be when I grow up. He's also the one that trained me to go into space. Space. Holy shit. Of course this would happen on my first mission. Hell, I didn't even know I was going until 12 hours ago. I was an alternate for Robbie Carlyle. I got a phone call at 3 a.m. telling me I needed to get my ass to Canaveral in the next hour. The official story is Carlyle suffered a sprain while working out. The real story is that he slipped in the shower getting busy with some girl other than his regular girlfriend. I've been listed as an alternate 6 times. After the 5th time, the astronaut I was alternating for defiantly refused to show up with the flu, a broken leg, or visible cold sores, I kinda gave up and decided I'd be going into space after about the 10,000th rich jerk-off tourist flew out of Mojave in one of those suborbital tin cans they call a spaceship. Then I got the call. I'd been waiting for that call ever since I decided I wanted to be an astronaut. Not because I wanted to set foot on Mars or perform earth-shattering experiments in microgravity, but because I wanted to fly things. The faster, the better. My heroes have always been pilots. From Chuck Yeager to Han Solo, I wanted to be the guy at the controls. A guy like Bennett. Bennett. Damn it. In some alternate universe, I was going to be a military guy turned NASA astronaut like him. Imagine my disappointment when I was 17 years old and walked into an Air Force recruitment center wearing my Coke bottle glasses and was told in no uncertain terms The only way I'd see the inside of a fighter cockpit was if there were paper towels and a bottle of Windex in my hand, so I could clean it for the guys with perfect eyesight. Pissed, I worked two jobs that summer, getting up hours before dawn to fold newspapers and deliver them. I can still smell the wet ink and feel the warm newsprint in my hands as it sucked all the moisture from my fingers. After that, I worked at Burger King during the day, getting laughed at by my friends as they came into the place imagining new and ridiculous ways to have it their way. Har har, guys. I used the money I earned to buy myself laser surgery for my eyes, which was something my parents couldn't afford, trying to raise three kids on one teacher's salary as my mother finished up her master's degree. With beyond perfect 20/10 vision, I walked into the Navy recruiter's office and was told, "Sorry, kid, LASIK was an automatic disqualifier." They changed the rule later, but it was too late for me. Uncle Sam wanted no part in making my dream a reality. I'd never be a guy like Bennett, a real American hero, trademark. Dejected and rejected, I decided I'd find other ways to take to the sky. I studied engineering and aeronautics in college and found that as a student, you could get cheap pilot training. I learned how to fly fixed wing, rotary, single engine, multi-engine, and even no engine in gliders and a hot air balloon. One summer, a couple of my flight school pals and I even took a trip to Russia and got to take control of MiGs. I did a crash course in Russian, afraid I'd try to change the air conditioner and end up ejecting myself over Siberia. To pay for it all, I spent my spare time volunteering for medical studies, where they poked me with different chemicals as I sat around playing flight simulators. When it came time to graduate, my friends all went into commercial aviation. I didn't. Flying a jumbo jet wasn't the same as going to the stars. So I took a job as a science teacher in my mom's school district. The same week classes started, iCosmos, the private space company with its own fleet of rockets, announced they were accepting applications for astronauts. I pissed my mom off when I turned in my school resignation after iCosmos hired me. Although it wasn't as an astronaut at first. They had plenty of former NASA people like Bennett who'd gone through their program to choose from. When the recruiter read the part on my resume about working for various pharmaceutical companies, you should have seen the fiendish look in her eyes when I explained I'd basically been a medical guinea pig.
"Oh, we need those too," she replied.
"Will it help me be an astronaut?" I asked.
"Sure, why not?"
she answered in that Northern Californian non-response. It didn't matter. Being a test monkey stuck at the bottom of a swimming pool for 10 hours in a leaking spacesuit, or finding out what happens when your cockpit chair snaps loose as the capsule goes rolling sideways down a hill, was a lot closer to being an astronaut than flying complaining tourists and neurotic flight attendants on the same route over and over. The day they finally accepted me into the iCosmos astronaut program, after nearly killing me on Earth 9 ways from Sunday, was the second happiest day of my life. The happiest was today, when I got the call. That all came to a fiery re-entry when I saw Bennett, the man who taught the most interesting man in the world how to be interesting, stick a gun into his pocket. "Man up, David. Go talk to him. Worst case scenario, and he actually is crazy, he'll just shoot me here on Earth instead of 200 miles up." 2. Glitter Menace. Acting as casually as I can, I finish sliding my chest unit into place and make sure all the lights are green. I double-check it, even though half a dozen people will take a look before I get into the capsule. Spaceflight is supposed to be routine now, but not that routine.
"What's up, Dixon?"
asks Bennett, looking up at me from his wrist display. "You know, suicide pills are a lot easier to pack," I say, in the weakest possible way, as I point to the pouch with the gun. He glances past me and sees the mirror.
"Watching me suit up? I didn't know you were into that."
This kind of locker room trash talk is a bit out of place for Bennett, not to mention the fact his son is openly gay and a Republican U.S. senator, elected in no small part because of his father's support. He's clearly trying to avoid the topic. I press on. "Seriously, is that some new SOP I don't know about?" Bennett takes his time as he examines his readout, then walks up to me, standing toe-to-toe, our chest units almost touching.
"Dixon, there are things you need to know, and things you do not need to know. I do not have time to tell you all the things you need to know. What I can tell you is that what you thought you saw doesn't exist in your world. Understand? But I'll humor you and tell you that because of certain security requirements for our payload, I'm required to take certain precautions."
He gives me a friendly clap on the shoulder and smiles.
"Don't worry, son."
I've seen the cargo manifest. We're just bringing standard supplies to the U.S. iCosmos space station. There are no military or spy agency payloads I'm aware of. But would I know? A line item that says 35 by 55 by 20 centimeter box weighing 2.4 kilograms listed as replacement carbon dioxide sensor monitor could be some NRO long-range LIDAR sensor designed to scan foreign satellites or something or other.
"I'm proud of you, Dixon. This is what it's all about. You're gonna do fine."
That's the Halston Bennett I know. The man who trained me and dozens of others in the iCosmos program. The guy we secretly try to emulate.
"Gentlemen, you all set?"
says Stephanie Peterson as she enters our locker section. Technically part of the cargo, she's a NASA astronaut we're taking to the station. An athletic, imposing former Air Force pilot, she's also the man I want to be when I grow up.
"I was just explaining to Yoga Boy how things are going to be."
"You just do whatever Halsey tells you."
She gives me a wink. I want to ask her if she knows about Halsey's gun. But by the informal way those two talk to each other, I get the feeling that if he's up to something, she'd either know or be in on it. Yoga Boy. Ugh. Bennett once caught me doing some stretches before a pool dive and never let it go. He's a great instructor, but never lets you forget who the real men are. The men and women who served in the military and were part of NASA's astronaut program. They were accepted from the best and the brightest. The twee posers like myself are just pretenders.
"Astronauts to the press room?"
Renata calls to us from the door.
"Let's go, Dixon,"
says Bennett as he gives me a friendly pat on the back.
"Time to tell them what it feels like to be about to have your space cherry popped."
It's disorienting, the way he just can switch right into the avuncular instructor, whose calm voice walked me through my underwater and zero-G training on our 727 Vomit Comet jet. It's hard to call it a press room, when at the moment it's a mostly empty auditorium with just 12 internet bloggers. On a real mission, something besides a FedEx run, the room would be full. Today, we get anyone with more than 10 Twitter followers and nothing better to do until their parents come home. It's kind of embarrassing, and nothing like the newsreel footage I grew up watching of astronaut press conferences. Vin Amin, the CEO of our company, insists that we do this before every launch.
Watch out for that one,
Peterson whispers to me, singling out a girl in crutches wearing a glitter-speckled t-shirt and purple streaks in her hair. She looks to be between 19 and 25. I pretend everything is totally cool, and my hero didn't just emasculate me moments before the most important day of my life. I'll be careful.
No, seriously. She once asked the NASA director a question about a contractor funding overrun that he didn't have the answer for. It nearly cost him his job and killed the program.
Seriously? I give the girl a hesitant glance. Leaning on metal arm crutches from some kind of condition, she doesn't look threatening. I keep a wary eye on her anyway as Renata starts our briefing. There's also a mischievous curl to her lips, like she's holding back something clever that I find alluring. Bennett explains how excited he is to be part of this program. Peterson talks about how thrilled she is to be going to the station and what kind of research she's going to do. I make an inane comment about being eager to ride shotgun, actually saying the word shotgun, and catching myself too late. Thankfully, the joke passes by, and I feel pretty sure Bennett isn't looking at me with daggers. Renata opens it to questions. The menace in the glitter shirt shoots an arm into the air and almost drops a crutch. Renata manages to avoid her as long as others have their hands up. There are the predictable questions about what it's like to be an astronaut from a group of people who look like the most adventurous thing they'll ever do is move out of their parents' basements. I get a couple technical ones about the new version of our space capsule. Finally, the only raised hand is Glitter Girl. I can see Renata's hesitation.
Okay, Lainey Washburn, you're our last question.
My question is for David Dixon. As one of the first astronauts to not have prior NASA or military training, what's it like to be the odd man out in a capsule full of veterans?
Did she just call Yoga Boy out for being a poser? I probably stutter and take longer than I should. Well, Lainey, the mission of iCosmos is to open space up for everyone. That starts when a regular guy like me gets a chance to fly next to a couple of real heroes like Captain Bennett and Dr. Peterson. She smiles at my answer. I mentally clap myself on the back. Before Renata can end the briefing, Lainey blurts out another question. Teetering on her crutches, she asks,
"When will people like me be able to fly for iCosmos?"
By me, I think she means handicapped. Gut punch. I flinch. I hope Bennett's gun is loaded and I get the first bullet. Thankfully, Peterson jumps in and saves the day, telling Lainey that both NASA and iCosmos have a program for making space accessible to all Americans. Lainey smiles at her answer, but keeps her eyes on me. I get the feeling she asked the question just to make me squirm. 3. Moving Target. It was a textbook launch, just like the simulator, except for the part where I'm worried my commanding officer is going to whip a gun out at any moment and shoot my brains out. The G's were more than I've experienced for a sustained period, but I've done enough gut-churning flight maneuvers to not be bothered. The real stomach twister happens a few minutes after we reach orbit. Launching to a space station is like trying to throw a baseball through a specific window of a bullet train as it flies past, if the train was going 17,000 miles an hour. You don't aim for the target. Instead, You calculate where it will be at a specific time, then try to intercept it. Launch windows are measured in half seconds for this kind of thing. You don't use a map so much as a spreadsheet. While we were sitting on the launch pad for 3 hours, the USI Cosmos flew overhead twice. If you've ever been out in the middle of the desert on a moonless night and seen the tiny speck of a low Earth orbit satellite or space station whiz across the sky, that's what we're trying to intercept. It's not even over the horizon when the launch computer fires the rocket. The launch computer controls everything. Joining up with a space station involves two other computers besides our own. There's the one at Mission Control in Nashville, watching everything and making sure tracking and telemetry jibe. Then there's the one controlling our destination, the USI Cosmos Station, doing things like adjusting the pitch of the solar panels every few minutes so the station will encounter less drag as it reaches the closest point to the atmosphere in its orbit, and controlling the tiny little thrusters that move the station out of the path of space debris. The station's biggest concern is fast-moving objects hurtling towards it, which is exactly what our space capsule is doing. At 17,000 miles an hour, a 1% margin of error in velocity means slamming into the station at the same speed as a race car at full throttle, enough force to destroy the structure. Before we even get close, we have to reach a parallel orbit matching its velocity. This is made all the more tricky because spacecraft, even the fancy iCosmos unicorn capsules, don't have a lot of fuel to burn. It's not like the Millennium Falcon, where you can just have Chewbacca take you to orbit on a whim and dodge incoming TIE fighters without worrying about fuel consumption. A little spreadsheet is keeping track of fuel, velocity, distance to target, and has lots of little triggers to tell us when we need to take a different course of action. All of this is automatic for the most part. Commander Bennett's job, and mine, is to watch our big flat-screen displays and keep an eye out for any flashing warnings. At some point in a normal launch, ground control will let him use the joystick to bring us closer to the station before the automatic docking computer takes over. This is really just giving a monkey something to press so he feels he achieved something. The iCosmos ships have done this kind of thing hundreds of times without anyone at the controls. But when there's human cargo, in this case Dr. Peterson, you want pilots on board for when all the computers don't agree, and letting the ship burn up over the Pacific Ocean isn't an option. 15 minutes after launch, I get a flashing box on my console, saying there's a problem with our trajectory. Commander, I'm getting a warning about our projected path.
I'm on it. Nashville, this is Unicorn 22. I'm getting a warning that our intended destination is unavailable. Over.
Unicorn 22, hold steady while we check on this. Over.
I flip through a few screens and realize the USIC station is sending us a do not proceed any closer signal. This would be from the computer system that watches out for any fast-moving threats.
Unicorn 22, we just heard from the USIC that they experienced a solar flare that knocked out their inbound telemetry sensor. They're gonna try a reboot. Continue your orbit until otherwise noted. Over.
A solar flare? I check through all my readouts and can't find anything from the Helios satellite. There's nothing about it.
Dixon, are you planning on arguing with their computer?
Says Bennett.
Which is preferable? They're right, or that their computer made a mistake?
Good point.
I shut up.
I pull up the reentry profiles. If we can't dock with the USIC, then we'll have to return to Earth. Like trying to catch the station, reentry is equally complicated. If we miss the window, we could find ourselves in the Pacific thousands of miles away from the nearest rescue, or worse, in hostile territory. Ideally, we hit the window at the right time and come back down over Canaveral, where we use the landing rockets to bring us down to the pad. Which could mean I'm home in time to grab dinner at Outback Steakhouse and get to sleep in my own bed. The alternative is a prison cell in North Korea, or burning to death in the upper atmosphere. Reentry profile's loaded, Commander.
Hold your horses, Dixon. Let's see what the folks at Nashville have to say.
Are you that bored of space already?
Asks Peterson from the seat behind me. She's joking, but there's something cold in her voice, like it was forced. She can't be scared, can she?
Unicorn 22, this is Nashville. We just spoke to the USIC commander, and she says they think there may be a sensor alignment issue, and they won't know until they do a spacewalk. And even then, it could be days. Please load up the re-entry profiles, and we'll tell you when to proceed. Over.
Affirmative, Nashville. Doing a systems check now. Over,
says Bennett.
Dixon, what's our ETA to a Canaveral window?
I'd already done the math. In 34 minutes, we'll need to start our re-entry burn. He nods, then starts going through screens on his console. Out of the corner of my eye, I see him digging through directories of all the onboard sensors. I'd never seen him do that in the simulator, but we've never been in this kind of situation before.
Nashville, this is Unicorn 22. It looks like we've got our own sensor issue on our heat shield. Over.
Suddenly, a bright red box starts flashing on my console, telling me there's a heat shield malfunction. I start to flip through sensor readouts and scan for anything that looks out of line, and then my screen goes blank. Confused, I turn to Bennett. I've lost my display. He relays this back to Earth.
Nashville, this is Unicorn 22. My co-pilot appears to have lost his display. I'm giving Dr. Peterson redundant controls. Over.
Roger that, Unicorn 22. We'd suggest a reset, but if you're experiencing a shield sensor issue, we advise against that. Over.
Affirmative, Nashville.
I reach out to touch my display to see if it was just a video issue. Bennett stops me with a sharp look.
Dixon, keep your hands off it. Peterson and I have this.
I have control, says Peterson. Checking heat shield sensors. Nashville, I can confirm we have a sensor problem of our own. We'd need to make visual confirmation to verify. Over.
Unicorn 22, please stand by. Over.
It's amazing how calm everyone can be when you just realize you've been fucked by the universe. The USIC can't let us dock, and we just found out we might burn to death on re-entry. Making things worse is the fact that I think Bennett intentionally shut me out of my screen so Peterson could have access. First the gun, now this. Something is not right. But I keep my mouth shut. 4. Hot mess.
Well, kids, any suggestions?
Asks Bennett while we wait to hear our fate from Nashville. Peterson types away on the console behind me while I stare at my own matte finish reflection in my screen. Bennett's question was rhetorical, at least in respect to me.
ISS doesn't have a spare docking collar, says Peterson. Checking on OPSEC. No, she's only got the Soyuz type free. What about New Star?
The Chinese station?
Says Bennett.
Didn't they have a rapid depressurization problem with their airlocks? I think I'll risk burning up.
She left out one option. There's the Korolev, I point out.
The K-1? Replies Bennett. There's a thought. Peterson, what do you see?
Pulling it up now. They've got a universal dock that looks free, although they're pretty cagey about non-Russians on there. They say the K-1 is for industrial research.
I think this is an extenuating circumstance. Nashville, did you get all that?
Even though we use a lot of overs and affirmatives, Our comm is always open. That's why the sting of Bennett telling me to keep my hands to myself hurts so much. It wasn't just Peterson who overheard it. Everyone I work with did.
Affirmative, Unicorn 22. We're checking on that now and putting in a call to Roscosmos. Over.
I'm gonna put a pin on our re-entry at this point until we've heard back. Over.
Roger that, Unicorn 22.
We spend the next half hour waiting for a response from the Russian space agency. While Peterson and Bennett run through their control panels, I stare out the window for the first time since we reached orbit. Our craft has a small spin, so it doesn't get too hot as we go through the sun side over Earth. While the stars are too hard to see through the internal glare of our displays, Earth is a bright blue and white disk that takes up the entire window when we rotate towards it. The hard thing to understand, even if you experienced it virtually, is how big the Earth is from low orbit. While we're in space, we're still only about 400 times the height of the tallest building in the world. The distance from the ground to my window is less than the trip from Cape Canaveral to Miami, a 3-hour drive for most people, half that for me. Space, technically speaking, is the place where you can orbit the Earth without running into too much atmosphere. If the Earth had no atmosphere and was perfectly round, you could orbit an inch off the ground if you were going fast enough. At our altitude of 200 miles, we're roughly just over 2% of the Earth's diameter away from the surface, which means the Earth looks really fucking huge even from here. But it's still far away. There is 200 miles of progressively thicker atmosphere below us. If we were just dropping straight down, that would be no big deal. We wouldn't need a heat shield. But we're traveling 17,000 miles per hour. People often get confused as to what it means to burn up in our atmosphere. It's not that the air is a giant oven up here. Quite the opposite. What matters is our velocity. At this speed, the friction from hitting those air molecules is so fast it's hotter than an industrial furnace. The skin on the bottom of our ship, Pika Z, is designed to handle atmospheric reentry from even higher velocities. The problem is if one part of it gets a little too hot, or there's an uneven spot. The Unicorn has reentry thrusters and is designed to land via rocket propulsion, but if we have to use them in the upper atmosphere to slow us down, then that means we'll end up burning all our fuel and need a parachute to land nowhere near our intended zone. The ideal situation is we get to dock with a station and check the sensors before attempting re-entry. If nobody has any room, then we're kinda screwed in the short term. Worst case scenario, iCosmos sends up another craft on autopilot in a few days to come get us, and lets the Unicorn 22 attempt an unmanned re-entry. Theoretically, it's a choice between trying to re-enter with a faulty sensor and hoping iCosmos can send up an unmanned craft for us to dock and transfer to, which is a lot easier said than done. Possible, but extremely time-consuming.
Hey guys, this is Vin here.
The face of Vin Amin, the CEO whiz who started iCosmos, appears on Bennett's display. It looks like he's Skyping from his home office.
I just want you to know we're doing everything we can to figure out a solution. We're having trouble figuring out what readouts you're getting, Halsey, but Dr. Peterson says she's getting the same thing?
Affirmative, she replies.
David, right? Any luck with your control panel?
I'm not sure if telling him Bennett won't let me touch it will go over very well right now. I just say, no, sir. He smiles.
Vin, save sir for Commander Bennett.
Any luck with Roscosmos?
Asks Bennett. Vin loses his smile.
Well, we're working on it. Zhirov, the head of their space agency, just gave us a flat-out no.
Sounds like that's our answer, says Bennett.
I don't know about that. I've got a call into his boss, Radin, the head of the Russian Federation. The two have been known to disagree. Plus, there's one more thing.
Vin holds up his phone.
I just tweeted that we're asking the Russians to let us dock at the K-1 because of the solar flare.
Bennett shakes his head.
You're hoping a bunch of people on Twitter will make Zhirov change his mind?
No. I'm counting on them to persuade Radin. He's a bit more media aware.
He looks at something on his computer.
Oh, good. Our hashtag, let them dock, is trending.
Jesus Christ. My life depends on a bunch of hipsters retweeting a plea from a man probably sitting on a yoga ball right now. 5. Party Crashers. I imagine some kind of high-level negotiation somewhere in a huge, dark, tapestry-lined Kremlin office where czars had been poisoned, disloyal party members had their death warrants signed, and pogroms were planned. All based on how high hashtag let them dock is trending on Twitter right now.
You have the post-docking re-entry profiles? Bennett asks Peterson.
It sounds a little presumptuous to me to start loading re-entry profiles for departing the station when we haven't even docked yet. We could be there 8 hours or a week, all depending on what our sensor inspection shows us. You don't plan a re-entry profile for a departure when you don't know when that's going to be. There are thousands of variations. Maybe Bennett is just running drills so he knows Peterson is ready to take the pilot seat? If that's the case, then that means he has no plans for letting me sit at a working display. Relax, David. Peterson has been into space multiple times. She's NASA. Bennett is former NASA. She's the one he wants working with him in a crisis. Yeah? But she hasn't been trained in all the iCosmos procedures. Putting her in my seat is one thing when my panel goes out mid-crisis, but leaving her there after we have a chance to switch seats or fix the problem, totally not cool. If Bennett is acting out of line, they'll say something downstairs. If I make a fuss, it'll only justify him taking me out of my role. Commander, let me know if there's anything I can do.
Will do, Dixon,
he replies, without even looking at me. I feel like a toddler sitting at one of those fake steering wheel consoles they put on the back of car seats. Hell, at least those did something.
Hey, guys,
says Vin as his face pops up on the display.
Man, those Russians. Whew, and I thought dealing with Chinese investment bankers was rough. Long story short, we got hold of President Radin's guy. I met him at an Aspen summit 2 years ago. Oxford educated, brilliant. Anyway, he took it to the man himself. Radin, as you know, has been trying to take a more diplomatic role, in no small part because falling oil prices are making them more dependent on foreign investment, etc. He said, sure, why not? Which is great. But then Zhirov, I'm told, lost his shit and said something about the universal docking ring not working on the K-1, which was news to me. So I called up Lena Golov. She's the actual mission supervisor for all the Russian launches. Great woman. I had her and her husband on my yacht last summer. We're trying to get her to come work for us. Fun to hang out with when she's all loosened up. Have you guys been to the yacht? You have to come out sometime.
Love to, says Bennett sharply.
Oh, right. So, anyway, I called her direct. She said her boss had no idea what he was talking about and was just, quote, being Russian about it. I love that. Anyway, I tell Radin's guy he should really talk to her. And he did.
And? Asks Bennett.
We're still working on it.
His screen goes dark. I can see the muscles tighten in Bennett's jaw. If he wants to use his gun to shoot the screen, I'd totally understand. I love Vinamine. What he's single-handedly done for space travel can't be measured. He's one of those people like Musk and Bezos who helped us start dreaming again. He's created 3 successive startups, each one worth more than the last. Then he bet everything on getting into the space business, going toe-to-toe with the upstarts and the giants. He's got balls. But he's also the guy in a YouTube video shot at Burning Man, walking around in a silver Speedo, high out of his mind, giving a rambling talk to his iPhone about why this would be the place to meet alien chicks for interspecies sex. I guess with that kind of brilliance comes a special kind of crazy. His crazy is what got us up here, and it's probably what it will take to get us down. I hope.
Good news,
says Vin as he pops back up on the display.
You got the yacht reupholstered?
Asks Bennett. Vin blinks for a moment, then bursts out laughing.
Oh man, you NASA guys. Hold on, I'm tweeting that one out.
And he, honest to God, picks up his phone and starts typing the tweet. I hope my will is in order, I mumble under my breath. This gets me a sly grin from Bennett and a snort from Peterson. Well, holy smokes, Yoga Boy finally managed to do something to get an acknowledgement that he's more than dead weight.
Where was I?
Says Vin.
Telling us if we're going to live or die, replies Bennett.
Right! Good news. They're going to let you dock at the K-1. And listen, just so you know, there were always going to be other options. I wouldn't let you guys down.
Other options? Does he have some secret rich person's space arc? Hell, who knows with Vin. Guys like him don't see anything as being impossible. I could almost imagine him telling us we're going to burn up on re-entry, but he's pretty sure his engineers have time travel figured out, so he'll just make sure it all never happens.
Zhirov is super pissed and has a bunch of conditions for docking with the K-1. Apparently they're doing some research on biofilms and whole sections of the station are off limits to us because of trade secrets. Can't wait to hear what that's all about. I'm sure one of their scientists will tell me when they get drunk on my boat and come asking for a job. Oh man, the stuff people tell you to impress you. Anyway, Mission Control has all the details. I'm gonna go look at carpet samples. Later.
I think that was a joke, but I'm not certain. 6. Airlock. In a bored, officious voice, a Russian mission control operator drones on to us about the rules.
No more than 1 American astronaut shall leave the craft at a time, and always with an escort. The American astronauts will be allowed only access to the docking pylon, the lavatory facilities adjacent to the pylon, and the airlock for doing their EVA. All EVAs will be under supervision of the K-1 commander or a subordinate in order to prevent damage to the K-1. No American may set foot on board the K-1 without permission from the K-1 commander. While Unicorn 22 is docked on the K-1, it is under jurisdiction of Russian Federation, as are all astronauts and passengers. We reserve right to inspect your cargo for any hazardous materials or contraband. If the commander of the Unicorn 22 agrees to these terms, please say affirmative.
I try to suppress a chortle every time he pronounces unicorn as unicorn.
Duh, says Bennett before turning on his microphone. Affirmative, Roscosmos. We agree to the terms. And thanks for helping us out.
We spend the next 2 hours bringing our orbit into alignment with the K-1. The computers mostly handle this. We've been linked up with Russian spacecraft since 1975, when Apollo and Soyuz craft docked and their crews shook hands. That was also the last flight for Apollo. On re-entry, there was a problem with the air system, and two astronauts had to spend weeks in the hospital recovering from lung damage. Let's hope this one goes a little better. After checking velocity, alignment, and all the other details that go into a docking procedure, we begin our final approach. Bennett keeps his hands near the stick, but I notice he avoids touching it at any point during the window where it's safe to do so. Through the porthole, K-1 gradually grows from a tiny white grain of sand to a space station the size of 2 football fields. Built like a giant cross from bus-sized cylinders, massive blue-black solar panels fill the squares between the pylons. The docking module is a shaft sticking out of the bottom of the station. 2 Soyuz capsules are berthed on either side as escape modules, the same kind that served as an emergency lifeboat on the International Space Station. In fact, the Soyuz modules were the workhorse of manned spaceflight for decades for the US and Russia. Until Elon Musk and Vin Amin came along, NASA wasn't too proud of the fact that after the shuttle program shut down, if you were an American astronaut that actually wanted to go into space, it was going to be on board a Russian space taxi. On the flip side, for me, it turned out that learning to fly a MiG gave me an upper hand in iCosmos astronaut training. Being able to understand all the switches on the spacecraft of necessity for the last 2 decades was a definite plus, along with my ability to not have to pee every 20 minutes. The K-1 fills the sky in front of the unicorn. Bennett's display shows the camera view of the nose coming into the docking ring as a computer voice calls out the distance in centimeters. There's an occasional burst from our docking rockets as they make fine adjustments to our approach. When we finally touch the collar, it's softer than a knock at the door. A metal ring clamps shut, and there's a tiny jostle as our ship is mated to the connector.
Unicorn 22, this is K-1. We have hard lock. Prepare for atmospheric equalization and to power down.
Before we can open the hatch and slap our comrades high fives, we have to make sure air pressure is equal on both sides. Otherwise, we could pop our eardrums, or worse, shoot out of the docking ring like a champagne cork while our hatch is wide open. Fun times. We put on our helmets just in case. The air begins to hiss as we equalize with the K-1, and Bennett powers us down. This is to prevent us from short-circuiting the K-1's electrical system until their electrician has a chance to make sure our power feeds aren't acting erratically. In space, there's no way to ground an electric current. If you have stray voltage, it'll find a path, no matter what. All the lights go out for a moment.
Dixon, whispers Bennett. I need to know right now. Can I count on you?
Yeah, sure. This is a little odd.
Listen to me very closely. I need you to do everything I or Peterson says. If you do that, it will all be fine.
I get the sudden realization that he's not talking about shaking hands through the airlock.
What's going on? Just listen. If anything should happen to Peterson or me, I want you to load up the re-entry profile she prepared.
Peterson leans in and taps me on the shoulder.
Be a good boy and stay on the unicorn. Everything will be okay.
He'll be good,
says Bennett.
Jesus fucking Christ.
This has to do with the gun.
What are you two up to?
I whisper.
Need to know basis. Robbie was supposed to be in your chair, until that retard screwed things up.
I think I need to know.
You can't know. Do you trust me?
In this exact moment, you're freaking me out.
Do you trust me?
Hell of a question to ask, after the gun pulling me off the pilot seat and whispering to me in the dark.
This is Bennett, an American hero. I've relied on him countless times underwater, dangling from parachute cords and sitting inside smoke-filled capsules simulating onboard fire. Yeah, Bennett, I trust you.
You're a good man. If it gets dirty, you have to bug out. Got it?
Dirty? What the hell? What about the heat shield sensor problem?
There is no problem. I can't give you specifics. It's better that you don't know. I just need to know that if Peterson or I tell you to launch, that you'll do that.
You mean without you guys?
Exactly.
You mean leave you on the K-1?
You won't be leaving us. We'll already be dead.
What the hell?
He puts his hand on my shoulder, just like the first time he shoved me out of an airplane.
This is bigger than us. A lot more is at stake. Can I count on you?
Affirmative.
What else could I say?
7. Border Patrol. I'm clenching my fists inside my gloves as the hatch swings open. Bennett's little pep talk has completely put me on edge. Now that the Russians are coming, I'm about to jump off the cliff of Anxiety Mountain. A round, Slavic face pokes into the airlock and announces,
"The American astronauts will please remain seated while Commander Yablokov conducts his inspection."
Bennett, back in his seat after opening the hatch, replies,
"Permission to come aboard."
I notice that no permission was requested, and as Yablokov drifts into the compartment, he barely even acknowledges Bennett. Yablokov somehow manages to look even more Russian than the guy who announced his entrance. Compact, with a shaved head, even though he's not in his military uniform, he still wears it somehow. I guess Bennett and Peterson are the same way. There's a composure they possess that sets them apart from slack yoga boys like myself. Yablokov rests a hand on the bar above the display consoles in front of Bennett and me and fixes eyes on Peterson.
"You are Lieutenant Peterson?"
"Retired,"
she replies. She spent 10 years in the Air Force, the last 5 on a NASA detail. She's only 31. It's weird to think of her as retired. Yablokov nods, then turns his gaze to me.
"You are not Robert Carlyle."
"No, sir. I'm David Dixon."
"Why are you here?"
he asks. While I'm pretty sure he means why am I filling in for Robbie, it kind of feels like a question about the reason for my existence. "Carlyle had a training accident. I'm his replacement." Yablokov fixes me with a stare. It's an intimidating, unflinching gaze, like he's waiting for me to confess something. Bennett is also watching me out of the corner of my vision. I notice his hand is casually floating in the air a few inches above the thigh pocket that holds his gun. I can't get Poe's telltale heart out of my mind. The gun is calling to me. My whole world centers around the pistol. I catch myself stealing a sideways glance at the pocket. I try to make it seem like I'm looking at Bennett for instructions. As a kid, I had a friend who did magic tricks. Whenever he tried to hide something in his hand, that whole side of his body would go stiff. He assumed that because he knew it was there, the whole world knew. When the only clue we had was his weird body language. Right now, I'm sure my body language says, "Commander Bennett has a goddamn gun in his pocket!" Deep breath. Yablokov is still staring. What would a less scared version of myself do? Smile, David. The best I can do is a slightly smug grin.
"You are not military," says Yablokov.
This sounds like an on-the-spot assessment, and not him recalling some fact from my profile he just looked over before drifting in. "No, sir. They didn't want me."
"I can understand why."
Damn. I just got zinged in space.
"Your face,"
he says.
"You wear everything on it. Your first mission into space, your ship malfunctions, and now you have to come to these scary Russians for help. Do not be afraid. Everything will be made okay."
He gives me what may be a smile, but looks more like something you'd do in the frozen wastes of Siberia to prevent your mouth from freezing. Yablokov pulls himself over to Bennett.
"Commander, you were given instructions by Roscosmos. I expect you will follow them. I hold you personally responsible for the actions of your crew."
"Affirmative," says Bennett.
He's trying not to show how much this chafes him to have the Russian treat him like a lost tourist. Yablokov slides over to the space between Bennett's seat and the wall of the capsule. For a split second, I think he's going to pat him down. He motions towards the storage lockers behind us. Those and a trunk under the capsule are where we carry cargo.
"What is your cargo?"
"I can resend the manifest if you like. Resupplies for USIC and Peterson's equipment."
Yablokov drifts behind us and unlatches one of the panels without asking.
"No unsecured gas cylinders or other hazardous materials?"
Other than the several hundreds of pounds of monomethylhydrazine fuel and nitrogen tetroxide oxidizer that will explode upon contact, we have sitting in tanks underneath us for landing, and a pistol in Bennett's pocket that could poke a hole through the tanks in a split second, blowing up the Unicorn and rapidly depressurizing the entire K-1 station, causing it to lose orbital stability and crash into our atmosphere where it will only imperfectly burn up, leaving a debris field 1,000 miles long. No. Nothing to worry about here.
"None of our cargo is dangerous,"
says Bennett, simplifying things. Yablokov pulls himself back to the nose of the capsule.
"Only one of you will be allowed out of the capsule at a time."
"That's not going to work, Commander," says Bennett. "We're required to do all of our EVAs in two-man configurations. In order for us to inspect the sensor, I need two of us."
"You will have a cosmonaut escort."
"I understand that, but it's a two-person operation, not a precaution. I thought they explained this to Roscosmos."
"They did, but this is at my discretion."
Even though our suits have gyros for keeping you balanced, and emergency jets if you somehow detached from the tether, a spacewalk can be a terrifying experience, especially on something unfamiliar like the K-1. The technology has advanced some since the first time men drifted out of the...
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.